Good morning. I'm going to take you all the way from Queensland down to South Australia, end of the river system. So my talk is about fish need flows in the Coorong, and I would like to acknowledge my colleagues at SARDI who are contributors to this talk. So Coorong, it's situated at the end of the river system of the Murray-Darling Basin. And as you appreciate, it's a unique estuary for the MDB, not just backdoor of the South Australian people. But it's quite a dynamic interface estuary present, but also got the Coorong lagoonal system along that 100 kilometers at the end. So it's also a Ramsar listed wetland, but also support a multi-species commercial fishery across the lakes and the Coorong and Ocean Beach. So river flow is extremely important for maintaining ecosystem health in the Murray Estuary and Coorong. So three key mechanisms. One is that Coorong normally have a salinity regimes and freshwater maintain their salinity gradient, usually from fresh to brackish toward the estuary area and then all the way down to become moderately hypermarine system. And also, all this fresh water coming down, you heard yesterday, it's important they're bringing the carbon food planktons and it's promoting the productivity in the Coorong and support a range of other organisms, including fish. And also, that connectivity is quite important. So usually when during the very dry years before, all the barrages were shut, so including the Murray mouth start to close. And even that fish ways, we need water to operate the fish way to maintain that connectivity, as you heard that Chris Bice talk about diagramous fish. So there are a range of fish species and a lot of recreational fishes. They would much appreciate all these large body fish, mulloway, black bream, flounder, and also mullet and golden perch. But also they support Lakes and Coorong commercial fishery. There are other fish, it's very small body or moderate size, like sandy spread, smallmouth hardy head, or bony herrings. But they are really important food for the fish-eating fish, or large fish-eating birds. And then diagramous fish is unique. And also that in the lakes, you've got those freshwater fish, which are threatened species that need protection, like pygmy perch and Murray cod. So all these fish have different kind of association with estuary. So we classify them to functional group. Diagramous fish, they move between marine and freshwater through the estuary to complete the life cycle. And estuary, true estuarine species, they complete their life cycle, breed and grow within the estuary, like black bream. But you've got these marine fish species. Some of them are marine estuarine opportunists. They come to estuary in large numbers, although they spawn in a marine system, but they could use the nursery as estuary as nursery ground, which is quite critical, say for mulloway and flounder. And then occasionally freshwater fish, they come down to the estuary either passively due to high flow or actively to the system. Now all these freshwater plays a pivotal role to maintain estuarine habitat, also the fish population health. This graph shows the annual barrage discharge over the last 33 years. And so currently under the regulated condition, the average discharge is actually below 4,000 gigaliter per year. But if you compare to that model pre-regulation, this is about 70% reduction of the end of the system flow. And apparently that frequency of no flow through the Murray mouth increased dramatically. And all these have massive impact to the Coorong system. So for example, a lot of study during the millennium drought is showing that massive increase in salinity. And also remember the overall flow reduction caused a habitat change, macrophyte reduction. We lost Rupia megacarpa, and also a big decline in Rupia tuberosa species. And also reduced connectivity. So during that millennium drought period, two dredges were in place, millions of dollars spent in dredging the Murray mouth for 8 or 9 years to keep the Murray mouth open so the system can breathe. But post that high flow since that late 2010, and in conjunction with delivery of environmental water through the end of the system, there are some improvement to the ecosystem. So to highlight and demonstrate the importance of flow for the Coorong and fish, here I'm using three large body species, Mulloway greenback flounder and black bream, as an example to demonstrate their flow response and why flow is important. So these three fish species have slightly different life cycle, life history. So first one, that Mulloway, it's a marine opportunist species. And they spawn in a marine system. So large flow coming up Murray mouth, if they form that, it promote them to aggregate, to feed and spawn. And then the egg develop rapidly into larvae fish, and the larvae quickly settle to the seafloor. And then they got strong swimming ability. They quickly move into, through the Murray mouth, into the Coorong estuary, and use that as a nursery ground to feed and grow up to, from 5 months up to about 6 years. And it's pretty critical that freshwater flow provide a refuge because it increased that turbidity, but also got food, and it's a protected area. So it's an important nursery ground for Mulloway. And then after about 6 years, they come out of the Murray mouth and go to the marine system, so life cycle. Greenback flounder is having similar life history. It's also a marine estuarine opportunist. And they basically spawn in a marine, and larval and juveniles, they drifted into the Coorong estuary and grow there. And they grow rapidly. Could support fishery within about 1 to 2 years. Black bream, in contrast, is very different. Black bream is a sole estuarine species, and they complete the entire life history within the estuary. So to show you the impact, during the millennium drought, we found that all these fish contracted to below the barrage, where it's a little bit brackish water or more marine system because of the reduction of flow. And the whole system basically is becoming from marine below the barrage at the end, and then gone away all the way here in the South Lagoon. There's no fish, even the most salt tolerant that smallmouth hardy had disappeared. And the salinity is about 4 times marine compared to that, 36 parts per thousand, that's marine water. So after 2010, that high flow, you found a expansion of these fish distribution all the way down. And for example, that black bream and flounder through our sampling and fisheries catch as well. We found them in the South Lagoon. So salinity is critical, flow is critical in maintaining that salinity gradient and refreshing the system. So our research data in the salinity tolerance, it shows that Mulloway are a bit less tolerant to high salinity compared to black bream and greenback flounder. So we're putting their salinity tolerance concentration against the salinity map. This is a model map. For the salinity maps before drought, during the drought period, and after drought. So the dashed line basically shows the salinity level when the fish shows stress by reduced feeding, is our experiment. And then the dotted line is showing about 50% mortality under that salinity level. And the x-axis is showing the distance from the Murray mouth toward the South Lagoon. Y-axis shows that the month from January to December. So as you can see that all these is showing that the contraction of the estuarine habitat actually reduced during the drought period. Now showing some fisheries production and abundance data. So you can typically see from Malawi fisheries catch and a few years, mostly it's commercial fisheries data, but a few years that light yellow bar is recreational catch. You see the increased production, usually with a few lags after that high flow. Same here. And we wonder, is that a recruitment response? Does flow show the benefit to recruitment? So we pulled out that the age structure, or that shows that during the drought, the production is very low, low flow. So age composition data of that 2000 and 2000 catch is showing that very strong cohort, both commercial and recreational fishery, 92-93 cohort is there. And this is from Greg Ferguson's PhD study. And then we had a look at the more recent catch, which is this year's commercial fisheries data at the Ocean Beach of Malawi. And it's already shown that this strong cohort of 2010-11, which is 6 year old, should be produced during that high flow, 2010-11. So that's great. Now, similarly, if you look at the greenback flounder, that high catch is also then again, normally that high flow, you see an increased catch after about 1 or 2 years left. And remember that flounder, actually, they grow really fast, and most of the fishery were dominated by less than 3 year old fish. So use a few age structure as example. And you see that you can also track that 2010 cohort for a few years. And this is 2011 cohort, so it's also a high flow year. Now, look at black bream. This is fishery production. It shows that in 1980s, there's a massive reduction in black bream catch in the Coorong estuary. We had 8 years age composition data. And from that, this time series data, you can see that there's a few strong cohort produced. So 2003-04 cohort. And then there was a secondary 1997-98 cohort. And more recently, 2006-07 cohort, tracked for 4 years. And then even 2009, a low flow year, you also saw some cohort. And it's interesting, actually, none of these are very high flow years, so they might have different flow requirement. So interstate studies is showing that black bream recruitment, that you really need that assault wedge, is called hollow climb, so that it's interface of freshwater and marine system, that creating that specific environment to promote their breeding. Now, despite these, there are a few episodic recruitment occur. However, the black bream is still maintained pretty low. So you don't see a population rebuild and recovery. So we did a stock assessment recently with a range of info, including this age structure. Another thing to mention is that black bream actually, they can live up to more than 30 years. Oldest fish we caught is 32. And so the population is not rebuilding, and you show a truncated age structure, lack of older fish. So as soon as they grow bigger, they were removed by fishery. So our stock assessment should define that there's a depleted stock recruitmentally overfished. So fisheries management and also in conjunction that with environmental management and flow management, it's quite important that these efforts need to put in place to protect the population, rebuild their resilience and complex age structure for the black bream population. So my last one. Also, this shows our recent study about the Coorong foot web. So basically looking at the last more than 10 years data, look at how the foot web responds during the low flow and high flow. So during the, we found that flow significantly increased the pelagic productivity against that, the benthic productivity. So benthic is still there. And for example, that sandy spread and all these fish become highly abundant, and they are important food for mulloway and also water bird. And also the food web complexity increase after increased flow. All these support fish recruitment and fish production in a Coorong. So my key message, freshwater flow is really critical for estuary habitat. Are you coughing against me? And that salinity regime, connectivity, productivity, it's all related, promoted by flow. And also that they improve the food web function and all the resilience of the system. Now, a collaborative effort is required for environmental flow, river operators, and fisheries manager to work together and with support of industry and local community to rebuild and reinstall that fish population resilience and ensure the long-term sustainability of key fish population. And all these need to be underpinned by rigorous science. And long-term data is quite important. So a lot of people to thank, funding bodies and yeah, a range of staff, fisheries and Ngarrindjeri people and a bunch of Saudi staff. Allow me a quick commercial. 2020. So welcome to Adelaide. Yeah. Thank you.